Yeah, so in the neutral zone, it's another one where you know, this is where turnovers happen. This is where the neutral zone is where you can win games and lose games as a team. You can become a real effective player, and it's what you're doing is you're denying the team to get down the ice if you do the neutral zone well, running interference with people so they can't get their speed. And it's not interference like you got a stick into someone and you glide with them. It's just, you know, you see someone running a route, you know the route they're running. It's just getting in the way a little bit, even though you're not supposed to. It's just enough to hold them up, or a little clip, or as you're skating by somebody, it's a little tap on the skates or a flick their stick or something to let them know that you're there and just to get them off their game a little bit. It's opening up. So on the offensive side of the neutral zone is opening up properly and getting low enough for neutral zone passes and breakout passes and stuff, and learning how to track properly on your back checks is another thing that I just wrote down there. Mm-hmm. So like the one thing that I learned, and it took me till junior and I figured it out on my own, I think I said this on the last podcast, is that when the puck used to go D to D, because the coaches weren't very good back then, the coach would go D to D, you know, I'd work hard and I'd attack that guy in a straight line, the first D on a straight line, and then they could slide it over. And then I'd hustle over to the other side, and it was an exercise in futility. It's like I used to sit there as I'm doing it going, how can I do this better? Because this isn't working. And then I learned the art of cutting the ice off. So this is neutral zone, right? Top of their circles to our blue line. When it was a D to D or something, I realized that if I come down the middle of the ice on a little with my stick, so if the puck's on the right-hand side of my right-hand side, if that D has the puck, if I had my stick out here, if he passed it there, he's dumb. So I've done a really good job. And then I start my angle. So what would happen is I'd actually kind of get underneath him a little bit, forcing him to the outside, and then put my stick in that lane again and took away more time. And what I was doing, I learned on my own, is I started pushing them off to the side, and it just made my job easier.
Yeah.
So without the puck, I was able to control, and anybody, not me, anybody can control the direction of play within a game by using your stick in the proper angles.
With way less effort.
Zero effort. There's a point where you steer. Mm-hmm. And then once you get a guy in your position, then you put some pressure on. Yeah. And the great thing about that is when people understand the system, when you see someone steering a guy like that, well, then all of a sudden everybody else follows suit because you know where the play is going to go.
Yeah.
And now pucks can't even get up the ice.
Yeah.
So it's so beneficial. It just made so it might not even appear like you're working hard, but you're actually doing a great job. So that's, you know, you're being efficient.
Yeah, you're being efficient. You're doing the job properly and you're being smart. And because, like, for people that are really offensively minded, like, this is another thing where you can be so gung-ho about offense, offense, offense. And this is one of those things where if you are just running around through the neutral zone, you're gassed.
Yeah, you're
so then tired. you get a turnover and you're too tired. You can't do anything. Whereas you do something like you're saying where you have just a good force, you get in a good lane, you have a good angle, those things you were mentioning earlier, and you're forcing a guy up the wall without a lot of effort.
That's right.
Now you force a turnover and you're still fresh to turn around and go the other way.
That's right.
Right? So even for just purely offensive reasons, it's just better to be like that.
Yeah, you're going to have the other team bobble pucks, or, you know, they're just going to be turnover fest.
Yeah.
And that's what you want, is you want to have turnover so you can get the puck going the other way.
Right. And I wanted to, a thing with coaching too, like, this is where it's really important that you pay attention as a coach of what you're teaching the kids, because this is where you'll hear them. If you see a guy that's floating through the middle, a mistake that coaches can make is be like, you need to skate. Like, you got to move your feet. Which is true. But as long as you have your feet moving into the push, it's not, you don't have to be going 110%.
That's right.
Just chasing someone when you know there's no chance of you actually getting the puck off that guy.
Right.
Right. But it makes sense. You keep your feet moving, obviously, and you just force him up and then let the play unfold where he gets pinched off the wall or whatever. And you don't have to go crazy.
Yeah.
But a mistake that coaches can make is yelling at that guy, like, you need to make, like, move your feet. You're not skating. You're not whatever, just because so many young coaches that are with young kids, they're all about, like, hard work and move your feet and work ethic without the smart part, though.
Yeah.
You know, so they kind of misplace that. So that was the first point I want to make on that.
Yeah.
And the other thing, I remember this is just being as effective as you can in all areas, like we're talking about. And you were talking about back checking. This was one that resonated for me because I had a unique experience in one of my games. I was probably, I think it was in my draft year, I think. And the guy that we were playing against, he played for London, and he was a really good player. He had worked with you a bit, ended up playing for the Spits.
Yep.
And we were on a back check. So he was back checking. I was on the offense and I was skating and I'm just gunning it, trying to get to the net. And he was on me on the track back, and he had the knob of his stick.
Mm-hmm.
So he choked up on the end of his stick just a bit, and he had the knob of his stick in my hip. Yep. And he was just like pulling just back enough. Just a bit. And I was like, I still remember it. Him pulling back on me, it was one, slowing me down just a bit, not like it was crazy. And we were kind of in lockstep, like going back. So it wasn't a penalty. It wasn't like he was holding me.
Yeah.
But it was just enough, like you said, I knew he was there. Just enough to now make me think about that instead of that. And I remember going back to the bench after, like, that is so freaking smart. Like, yeah. That is so freaking smart.
He's just in your grill?
Yeah, so he's just in my grill. He doesn't have to work as hard now because he's giving me that little bit of a yank and just getting away with what he can get away with, right?
Yeah.
And it's in my head now that he's right on my hip.
Yeah.
And that's perfect. Like, what a great job.
Yeah.
And that was the guy that he ended up getting drafted super high. He was an awesome player, one of the best players in our league.
Yeah.
And went on and played his years and then went and played in college after that.
Yeah.
But that's one of those things where it's like this guy always being effective. So not only was he a really good offensive player, that was one of those times where I remember it resonating with me, like, wow, that is so smart. And somebody noticed that. A scout would notice that.
100%.
Because if he's smart enough to do that on the back check, he's smart enough to do a lot of other things without the puck.
Yeah.
When the game's going on. So those are things that make you more valuable as a player, right? It's not just offense. And it's so easy to think that even when you're a kid, like, I got to score all the goals. But these other parts, there's all these little things that you can do that to help, right?
Yeah.
And it saves you the price of energy when you can be more efficient at these things.
Yeah. Another thing like that is that when you are coming back to your own end and you know that these guys are rushing and making a good rush and stuff, it's just taking a step, you know, like, you're coming this way hard and I know you're coming, I'm back checking. If I just take a step and just get not interfere where I'm holding you, but just get in your way, and it just slows you from getting to your roots. It's just like that little tiny thing that slows you down, and it gives my D or whatever, or take away that option. It gives my D or my other teammates more time to make decisions, and you just disrupt their plays. It's a little thing that, again, a lot of people wouldn't notice, but it's a good thing. And then, again, communicate things is like when you are back checking or neutral zone, like, okay, let's say we're defending a breakout or whatever in the neutral zone, a D to D, whatever. And just talking to your line mates, right? Like, I got him, I got the middle, stay high. All these little coaching cue words that we use as players goes a long way too. It keeps you in the game. You're communicating with your guys. On the back check, you know, I got him, you know, and just yelling at that, like, or pointing and letting guys know where you're at, what you're doing or what they should be doing, because you can see something evolving and you communicate that. It goes a long way with your teammates too, right? Because the game's played fast.
Well, all this stuff contributes to, like, the hockey IQ thing. And I remember another, like, little catch coaching thing that people would say is, like, just hold your ice. That was, like, the code phrase for, like, run interference without running interference.
Yep.
And a really clear example of doing stuff like that, if people can't visualize what you're saying, is like off a face-off.
Yep.
A lot of times, especially with the wingers lined up, when the puck's dropped, a lot of times you lock up with the guy that you're next to. Yep. So if the puck, if you win the draw and the puck goes back to your D, most of the time guys will do this without even thinking about it a lot, is they'll just kind of stick on their guy
because
that winger's trying to break through to go force that play now because they just lost the draw, and you just run a quick
interference.
And you're just standing where you would have stood kind of thing, right? Yeah. You're not grabbing him or obviously getting in his way. You're just staying where you would have stood.
Yeah.
And that little delay gives your D an extra second to corral the puck, get his eyes up and look and make a play, right?
Yeah.
And that's all that hockey IQ stuff, because again, somebody that's watching that knows hockey will see that and be like, oh, that D could just get a nice clean, you know, D to D up the wall because that winger got in the way of his winger. So he couldn't get that middle ice force like we talked about before.
Yeah, I actually had that in there on face-offs. I just call it squeeze or tying guys up.
Yeah.
It's squeeze. And so we'll just cover that right now because it's the same, right? Every face-off, you always assume that you're going to lose. Always assume it's a 50-50 at least. So I call it a squeeze. You can make sure that you get on – have your guy and take care of the puck first, then make a decision, unless it's a totally designed play with a second left or something like that. And by doing that, you really can't screw up your face-offs. And face-offs means possession or not. So if you're in the wrong position, if you lose, if you make a mistake on a face-off that turns into a goal, that's not a good thing.